So I'm sure all of you have done an email in your life. I mean, it's very common, especially here at school. You have to email your professors all the time. But once you get out of the business world, there are a few key things that you need to learn. And we're going to kind of go into some of the smaller details that you probably don't think about.
Giddy up.
So obviously, you want to double check before you send any email out. So Vanessa is going to talk today about the different email domains, the different companies you can use, why you should choose different ones. Michael's going to talk about the different attachments, zip drives, you know, things such as that, because there's a lot out there now. Sean is going to talk about the different signatures that you would use in the business world, and also the ones that you would use as a student, because they do vary quite a bit. And then I am going to wrap it up with some of the little common errors that most people probably don't think about that you should double check before you fix it.
Okay, so the domain. The domain is a very important aspect of the email. It goes after the at sign. And it ties you to a larger entity, such as our email ties us to the School of Mines, or if you have an email through a workplace, it ties you to the place that you work, so it's a very professional thing to keep in mind. If you have, also there's different domains and providers that kind of have weird domains after the sign, and that can easily be put into someone's junk mail or spam. And that can be very dangerous if you're trying to apply for a job and they are spam. And then the provider, so some of the major providers that you guys are most definitely familiar with are Yahoo, Google, AOL, and Outlook. Those are probably the biggest ones that we use as a society. Every provider kind of has different traits that will benefit you and what you're looking for. So we all know all the wonderful benefits that Google has, because I think School of Mines kind of pushes Google on us. But there's also a lot of providers that you might not know about. There's one provider that's called Yandex, and that's the most popular search engine in Russia, but they also provide free email. And some of the really cool things you can do with Yandex, you can type up an email and have it defer so it sends a couple days later or a couple hours later. I'm not sure maybe why you would use that, but that seems like something that could become useful in the workplace. Also, it will remind you if you haven't received a reply to an email in 5 days. And I thought that was really useful and interesting, because you might forget you sent something out and didn't even receive a reply to it. So I think that's a really cool aspect of Yandex. There's also mail.com, which I thought was really interesting because it allowed you to change the domain, like what it displays, so you could tie yourself to things like engineer.com or lawyer.com. It seems kind of silly, but it's just a different way to kind of put yourself out there in a different matter. You could also use like myself.com or cheerful.com. Some of them are really silly and you shouldn't use, but I thought that was an interesting aspect. Also, there's another provider called Zoho, and their email service is 100% ad-free. So that was also really interesting. I'm not sure how they can go about that 100% ad-free, but it is. So that's just kind of tying the domain and the provider together. And now Michael's going to take off with attachments for us.
Alright, so whenever you're attaching files to your emails, a lot of times the provider is going to be putting a limit on the file size. So for example, Gmail and Yahoo limit the size to 25 megabytes, and Outlook is 10 megabytes, and AOL is 50. There are a few other options that you can pick when you're attaching files. One of them is to create an expiration date so that your file will expire after a few days. Make sure that your file is not corrupt when you send it to your recipient. You should download it directly from your email to make sure that everything's okay. If it's corrupted, then you can change the file format, or you can change the file name to something else. A lot of times I've found that creates problems. Or you can convert the file format to something that's easier to deal with on the other person's computer, such as a PDF, a JPEG if you're sending images. But you wouldn't want to save it as something like a .psd, which is a Photoshop file. But just remember, if you're sending a PDF file to the other person and they need to edit it or like change it in any way, it's really hard to change the PDF once it's created. And if you need to send bigger files or you need to send multiple ones and it exceeds the file size, then you can create a zip file, which compresses all the files into a smaller space so that the provider can send it to the other person. And a few providers, such as Gmail, they can, if you mention the word attach or some attachment in your email, and you forget to attach something, Gmail will remind you.
The last part of your email is obviously the signature. It's kind of an important part. You might not think it's that important, but it does serve a purpose. It offers alternative contact detail for any employer or someone who needs to contact you again besides just through email. It gives off pertinent job titles and company names so they have an idea of who they're getting the email from or who you are and what kind of titles you want. And they also, like I just said, they give an idea of who the recipient of the email is if you haven't been in contact with them for a while. And you can go wrong making a signature in a lot of ways, even though it's just something that's really simple and tiny. But the most important thing I found online was that you need to be concise. It should only be about 3 to 4 lines long. Any longer, it's just too much, and it's not a good signature. And you should include content that shows your expertise, like I just said, pertinent job titles or any accomplishments or degrees or anything like that. And you should include your email in your email signature, which a lot of people don't know that. It's just a little bit redundant because they can just hit reply or go to the top of the email and see your email. And when you're sending out an email for business or school or anything that's professional, you should use only your school or business email. You shouldn't use a personal email because that reflects on you poorly and makes you look a little bit more unprofessional. And email signature's only purpose is to let the recipient know who you are and how to get in touch with you. So if you just remember that when you're making one, it should be pretty straightforward. Here's an example of a good email signature, just straight, simple, important, his name, what his title is, where he works, and a number to get a hold of him, probably a business number. Here's a really bad signature. I don't know why he has all this. He doesn't need his blog or his wife's number, or are we going to go to his house and hang out with him or something? I don't think so. And quotes, another huge thing, do not put a quote in your email signature. That is just don't. It looks unprofessional, it's bad, it's wasted space. Here's what you should include in your signature, short, simple, and sweet, your phone number, name, first and last, your company position, and titles. And like I was talking about earlier, we have college and business email signatures. They differ just a little bit. Your college signature is going to be a little longer than your business signature. It's going to include your major or your minor if you have one, the school you're attending, when you expect to graduate, and you can add a phone number if you'd like. Normally people don't, but it's just another way to get in contact with you if you don't check your email or if they want to call you for whatever reason. And another important one that positions you hold on campus, like if you're the leader of a club or a president or something, or you work in the lab or you do research, you should definitely include that in your college signature. And then, like I said, for your business signature, just your first and last name, business phone number, company you work for, and pertinent job titles. And here's some examples of a good signature for a college student. It just got her name, title she holds at the college, and her degree and when she graduates. Same thing with that one, they just included their number. And here's a bad signature. Can anyone tell me some errors that's wrong with this? Anyone? Yeah, you definitely should not include a nickname. Very unprofessional. He's got a quote, and the other thing I forgot to mention is when you make your signature, a new thing that's becoming nowadays is to make your signature one picture for your email, and have something like this where you just have all of it in one picture and you attach it to every email. And that's actually not advised because it might not load right for sending an email to someone else, or it might be a corrupted file, and then you have no signature and your email looks all weird. Here's another one. You can look at that and you just know that it's not a good signature. You don't want an email from this guy. He's very unprofessional. And it's in Comic Sans, the worst font. Everyone knows, why would you choose that? And we're gonna go from this year with some common errors in emails.
Okay, so when you're first starting out to send an email, the first thing when you pick a company and you are picking your name, you want to use a professional one. You do not want Mama 55 or anything like that. Even putting like video game names in your email, I mean, if you're trying to get a job and they see that's your email address, they're going to think, okay, this guy's immature, this girl's kind of immature. So you always want to do that. And especially in business, you need to do like mine is acevedo.misty, because there's another Misty Acevedo out there and she's and then that way when they get the email, they know who they're getting it from, and it's not just instantly spam. You know, I don't know this person, and I don't know how long 55, so I'm going to put them in spam. And then you always want to double check who you're sending to, because as you saw in that first video, she didn't double check, so she sent that to the entire office. And obviously that is kind of embarrassing. And you don't want to, especially working in an office, you do not want to, like, complain about another coworker, and then somehow that coworker gets that email also, you're going to cause a lot of problems in the business. So always double check before you hit send. And you spell check every time. And we've talked about this in class. Misspelled words will make you look less intelligent. And if you're trying to get a job, you want to put your best face forward. Otherwise, they're going to just throw you aside and pick someone else who actually knows how to spell. And make sure before you get sent, you go over everything again and double check, because once you send it, you cannot unsend it. And then I'm going to show you a couple emails that are obviously have a lot of issues. Like her name, Pasta. It's 112. Do not use emoticons. Do not use text speak. And then when you are attaching files, you want to make sure you name them so when they download it to the computer, they don't just have resume, doc, and then you have 500 of them, and then how are you going to find the one you're looking for? So always make sure that you title those appropriately with your name. And I don't know why her resume would be 43 megabytes unless she just included her entire life story in that. So pretty much her entire email looking for a job is... This one, if you would look at it at a quick glance, you will think that it is actually a pretty good email. And now you look, because email address is Mortal Kombat. He does not actually give his name throughout the entire thing. He says, my name is Martinez. Okay, is that your first name? Is that your last name? He doesn't give him contact information. And he kind of rambles on. And you want to give it, especially in something like this, when you're trying to get someone to help make a decision or something, short to the point, so that
so that other people can edit or view it in the most convenient way possible. Sean shared with you guys appropriate signatures in the professional and school world, but being a college student, it's very important to have a professional college signature. And then Misty talked about some common errors that I'm sure we will meet at some point in time. Do you guys have any questions?
So, for the signature part, you know, when you said, like, that picture,
mm-hmm.
signature, do they have options for you can, every email that you send is just, like, part of the text signature, it's on point text that you can send, or what you send?
Yeah, they have that option.
So what she's asking is if there's an option like on your phone where you can set your emails to have a signature every time you send it, so you don't have to type out your email.
Sure.
And there's this option to do that in emails. I couldn't tell you right off the top of my head where it is in most of them, but I know all of them have that option in them.
If you go through settings, it will, in your settings option, it'll ask, do you want to have a signature, and then you do your appropriate signature, whatever signature you put in there, and then just hit save. So, did that answer your question?
Excellent.
Yes.
I know you had mentioned before that those email services were free. Were there any paid email services you came across?
So, he's asking if there were any paid email services that I came across, and there are a few, not necessarily their own entity email service, but like you can purchase, I think it was a Boomerang account, and then that will help make like advanced Google a little more. Like you can do a few more things, like what I was talking about with the index, that you can get emails deferred and have them have the email sent an email like that no one's replied to you, but that's a paid service. Or any other entity that will attach itself to your email. Yeah, but I didn't come across any like paid email services. Did I answer your question?
Okay, for the sake of time, I'm going to stop it there, but good question.